Zach, it's good to get a hold of you. It's been a busy week. You and Brittany added a third one to the rider roster in the group family. So congrats on that. And also congrats on doing it on your guys' terms at the house and everything. You know, you've really made being a dad look really cool, and you've taken on a lot of challenges for it. So just to start off, how's this week been?
Yeah, everything's been great. Like you said, we had a home birth, so it's been really mellow. Just kind of getting to stay at home and spend some time with the family and our newest one, and just really enjoying it.
You know, you guys have done a good job too, even kind of counting down and stacking up as much time with the other two before this one got here. I liked all the little adventures you guys did around Florida.
Yeah, definitely. We you know, we're a pretty tight-knit little clan, and we just felt like, you know, there's going to be some time here over the next couple of weeks where we're not doing schoolwork with the kids and we're not doing all of our normal, you know, they're very, let's say, ritualistic or regimented, and they know each day what's going to happen. So, you know, this is going to throw them off their routine a little bit. So we just try to kind of make it special for them too, and let them be a part of all of it, and really try to integrate him into our family as easily and seamlessly as possible.
So you're one of the guys that is part of this new generation of racers that's not afraid to have kids. You know, for so long it was like this big stigma, you know, a kid's a half a second a lap or whatever. You really helped kind of change that outlook on things. How is it as a racer to do that? You know, because a lot of people know I have a kid now, and so I start to see a lot of the things that you guys have been going through in these last few years, and finally I'm like, aha, I get it. What did you understand when you started going through it, and what do you see now as a father of three?
Yeah, for me, I mean, each experience is different. That's one thing. You know, each child is so different, and the way that you have to approach it, and the way that you see them, and the way that they see you, you know, it's all just a brand new experience every time. But for us, it was just, I mean, it was just what made sense, and how we always kind of envisioned it for ourselves. And we never wanted to, like, we wanted them to fit into our life and get to enjoy those things too, you know. And now with Emery being a little bit older, it was, even if I didn't stop with motocross and supercross last year, it was time for her to stop traveling because it was starting to be a burden for her. And, you know, she didn't want to go every weekend, and she wanted to be at home, you know, during the week. And so that was, you know, a new experience for us. Whereas the first 4 or 5 years, it was like, okay, you know, load up, we're going wherever. And she was like, all in. But it started to come to a point where she was like, I don't want to fly, you know. It started to be a burden to her, and that was a bummer to see. But now she's super fired up about this because we're going to get a motor home and drive to the races, and, you know, get to take some adventures and not just be kind of stuck in one race gear that you get stuck in when you're racing supercross and motocross, and you have to be back to work on Mondays and all those things. So this is a really cool opportunity for us, you know, moving forward, to again integrate the kids and give them experiences that they otherwise wouldn't have had if we weren't going racing, and just be able to make memories and have a good time again.
I like that. I like that. That makes a lot of sense, especially with the way you guys go about everything. You know, the kids are always a big priority into that. I'll say the same. You know, I can attest to seeing guys go through different things at different points in their careers, and kind of understanding, like, oh, okay, this is maybe the cause and effect of these results or whatever situation they're in. And then, you know, to understand, hey, life changes. Understanding that for myself now has been a big deal, because for so long I was always like, I'm just going to go to every race forever. And then you start to see, like, oh, it does get a little bit different. And you guys go through that, and the pressure that comes from training, being expected to perform as well as you guys do, have all the other things you guys have. That's a lot on your plate for sure.
Yeah, definitely. And you know, like, it's part of our balance, like, as a home as well, like going racing and getting to travel and do those things. And this year, with my program, it wasn't really like that. It was just sort of me going on the weekends, and that was a new, something new for all of us. And, you know, obviously I know that at the end of this 2 years, I may take on one more year or whatever, but after that, it's going to be pretty much over for me, you know, going racing as a professional. Like, I'm going to be almost 35 by the end of this deal, which is crazy. But, you know, for us, it's a little bit finding what's next after that, and still being able to travel together and just kind of find a rhythm outside of life. We never really felt like we found that, or outside of racing, in life outside of racing, sorry. We never really felt like we kind of tap that this year just because I was going so much. We didn't really know what we were doing. There was different races, different programs all the time. And we were just kind of all over the place. So this gives us like a nice transition to be able to still race and do it at a high level on good equipment and with good people. But at the same time, you know, almost a little bit of a transitionary period out of like that, like I said, everyday supercross motocross grind where you have to be there 7 days a week turned on at all times, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, totally. In the press release, you had even said this opportunity had kind of really started ruminating in 2007. So 15, 16 years later, here you are. What really made this come together? You know, you did a GNCC at one point this year. You've been around the pits. Everybody knows you want to keep racing. So how did this come to be with Yamaha?
Yeah, well, I mean, in 2007, it wasn't really... On my side, like, they were like, yeah, maybe we can do something. Like, I didn't have anything. Like, I had bought a Yamaha. I was hoping to get on Yamaha Troy. And I was also like, maybe I can go woods racing. Like, anything to continue racing, making money was basically what I was looking for. And with the economic crisis and everything that was pending at that point, like, it just didn't make sense in the end for them, so they didn't have anything for me. But I actually reminded Randy of that the other day, like, hey, do you remember in 2007 we were talking? And he was like, kind of, somebody mentioned that the other day. And but he really didn't have nearly as much of a recollection of it as I did. But actually Ziggy from Factory Connection is the one who kind of made the connection between Randy and I, and he had known, you know, since I was up there in April or May or whatever it was doing some testing, that I still had you know, some fire to go racing. And I think some things opened up on Randy's side with some people leaving and coming and going, and it just made sense for me to give him a call, and I did. And it just kind of blossomed.
So why XC2? I think so many people expected you know, this 250 guy that's been everywhere, 450 outdoor champion, just jump right into the big leagues of it. But XC2 is going to bring its own challenges.
Yeah, I mean, for me, I'm a beginner, right? Like, that's like asking Stu or Ben to go race Supercross in the 450 class. So these guys know these tracks. They know these places. They know the dirt. They know the scenarios. They know race strategy. You know, I'm starting from ground zero, basically, just with a team of guys around me who have a good understanding of it. So I'm going to have to really lean into them. I'm using this year to learn. And then, you know, obviously next year I'll be an XC1. So it's going to have to be a quick curve, and I'm going to have to hit the ground running.
That's a very important point that I think a lot of people, especially motocross people, aren't going to realize. The awareness of these tracks that are pretty much the same. I mean, they go to the same locations year after year, but the little tips and tricks and, oh, that's going to be a muddy area, or this is that in the woods, like, they do have a big advantage over you. After riding those courses for myself, yeah, they do have a big advantage.
Yeah, it's not even only that. It's like knowing the properties and knowing how to get back to the pits in the event that something happened, knowing where you're at on the property, learning, you know, the trails, and there's a lot to it. You know, it's racing at a high level, the highest level for a reason, right? Like, that's professional off-road racing at its peak, other than maybe Dakar, in my opinion. But for me, it's just going to be learning all those little tips and tricks, like you said. And you know, I've been on the podium in XC2 quite a few times before, but at the same time, the sport GNCC racing has moved on a ton since then. And, you know, I'm realistic in knowing that I'm not just going to get in the class and destroy the boys. Like, they're racing every weekend for the last, you know, 5 or 6 years, most of them in this class. And, they're no joke. So it's not like I'm like, oh yeah, I'm going to just drop down to XC2 and win that, and then just move up to XC1 and win that too. Like, that's not what I'm, you know, where I'm at mentally. I'm mentally like, hey, I need to learn. I need to do good. I need to grind out some results and see where it takes me. And, you know, there's another big step coming right up after this one.
That's a very good outlook because, yeah, exactly like you said, these are the same kids that have been coming to these races forever, you know, even maybe back as mini bike riders.
Yeah.
And, the XC2 talent is good because it's a young, really diverse set of people. There's, you know, South Americans that are coming into this thing now. It's not a joke. It's not just some, like, support class. It's fast.
No, it's not at all. I mean, like, Lyndon, the guy who won this year, Lyndon Snodgrass, he was close to winning a couple of overalls, which is, like, you know, winning the 450 class as well. And that speaks volumes of him. You know, I think that those guys are all in tip-top shape. You know, the professionalism of it, the whole paddock has come up so much since I was doing them in like 2013, 2014. So it's cool to see that progression, you know, in a rather short amount of time from, you know, most guys and sprinters and box fans and one or two semis to a bunch of semis and, you know, a bunch of high level programs that are going racing every weekend.
Mm-hmm. So then you're also signed up for some select sprint enduros. For people that don't know, what's really the big difference between those? Because you've done almost every discipline of off-road at this point now, huh?
Yeah, I've done most things. So sprint enduro is like a time test. I'm not totally familiar with the U.S. sprint enduro format, but I believe it's two different tests, an enduro test and a cross test, which will be obviously enduro test is like more wooded, more, you know, rocks and stuff. And then the cross test is like grass track or sometimes some motocross or whatever. And you're timed on those tests three times each. So six tests a day and then a cumulative score over the 2 days, and the best time wins, total time wins. So that's going to be something new. I've done that format in Europe racing at 6 days, and it's something that I really enjoy. So I'm looking forward to some sprints. I really, really think that's going to be good going into the season. I think I have three sprints before the first GNCC, which will kind of break me in, give me some good feedback and good knowledge on my bike, and just kind of open me up to racing again. You know, I've been racing quite a bit this year. I think I raced 15 or 16 times, and it was good, but there's nothing like really racing with that race pressure, and having some knowledge from that will be key to my season, I think.
You know, dude, really thinking about what you're going to do this coming next 2 years, you know, endurance races, which you love. I mean, you're just a glutton for pain. But then the math and the strategy that you really nerd out about too, this is like right up your alley.
Yeah, it really is. And that was a huge part of, I mean, I think I said this in another interview, but like when I took my Husky deal in 2015, leaving Geico, my wife and I had kind of discussed like, you know, I'll do these 2 years of motocross and supercross. If it works out, cool. If not, no big deal. You know, they have a great off-road program. We'll go off-road racing, and, you know, she can go back to work as a nurse and I can, you know, we'll go racing on the weekends. And that was kind of our plan. And then obviously 16 turned into 17 and 17 turned into 18. And here we are, you know, things went differently. God had a different plan for us, but, this has always been something that's been on my list and something that I've wanted to do. And, something that I felt I could excel at. I enjoy riding in the woods, and, you know, I still love to ride motocross if the setting is right. You know, if the track's super rough and it's hot as crap, that's when I want to go ride motocross. But I really just don't have any major desire to go and ride a smooth track and throw whips or whatever. I'm not a very good whipper, right? So, so like the woods racing thing has been a good change for me, because when I ride motocross, I know what it's supposed to feel like when you're in shape, you know, your bike's perfect, everything's working, it just the way it should be. I know how that feels, and I know it pretty fresh, right? Like within the last year and a half. So for me, when I go riding in the woods, it's like I'm always learning something new. I can start to find different things, and it's just like a whole different look at dirt bike racing for me at this point in my life. And that's something I've been stoked about, and I've just really been having a good time riding my dirt bike.
So then again, as so many people have said in the industry, you have to go see a GNCC for yourself, and you've done quite a few of them. For people that don't know, that have never gone to one, what is that attitude or what's that environment like on the weekend? Motorhomes as far as you can see. And I think the biggest thing that it really comes from it, so many people that pay to really abuse their bikes and then go right to the dealership again on Monday or Tuesday or Wednesday and then buy parts to do it again the next time that the series comes through. I mean, it's the core fan that really appeals to me in that series.
It is the core fan. And, you know, I mean, it's hard to go to a GNCC and wonder why, like, those guys aren't on the pay level of motocross and supercross guys, because there's so many people and so many bikes. And just, I mean, obviously I know that the exposure for supercross is crazy, but like the grassroots exposure for GNCC is untouched, in my opinion, on the motocross side of things. So for me, it's such a cool thing to see so many people. Like, you know, I grew up in motocross, obviously, and I grew up in that, like, you know, secret training, all this stuff. And in GNCC, it's very much more open and loose, and like just people talk to each other, and it's a much more fun, laid back atmosphere. And I can see how people get drawn to that compared to going the motocross route. You know, their race is A, timed. You know, they're going to get way more riding time, and B, it's at a set time on the weekend. So like it's a much more easy plan. You know, you go to a motocross race and there's like 50 motos and you're this moto and it's five laps and then you wait, blah, blah, blah. So to me, the format of off-road racing is kind of where the appeal is right now for people coming across from motocross.
You know, you would never be a guy to say like, yeah, I'm going to put the weight of this on my back and try to draw in all these motocross or supercross fans to off-road. But I'm sure there's a piece of you that does want to know, hey, maybe there are going to be some people that are going to be more interested in this series because a moto guy is going over to it. Maybe they get more interested in it. They come to Ironman or they come to, you know, the Penton GNCC or whatever when it comes through.
Yeah, I believe that's possible to bring some people over and to bring some fans over. You know, I know, like, just from my relationships in motocross and supercross, like, I was talking to Chase the other day and he was like, man, I really want to do Ironman. And I'm like, no, you don't really want to do 3 hours in the middle of your 3 weeks of off season. Like, but I get it, you know? So there is some desire there from people that are good riders that want to go and race GNCCs and stuff. So, you know, if I can do well and everything goes great over these 2 years, I would love to see some more people follow after me, whether it's, you know, at a high level or not. Like if they want to go factory racing or if they want to go grassroots with their kids on a Saturday, that's okay too. I mean, for me, it's just such a much more laid back, fun side of things, right? So, you know, all of us motocross guys have experienced this like amateur motocross grind and all that stuff our whole lives, and then you go to one woods race and you're like, man, this is how fun dirt bike racing actually can be. You know, I'm not taking a dump on motocross by any means. I don't want you to think that, but at the same time, like this, you know, the woods crowd is just different.
Yeah, no, I completely understand. And I don't think anybody would think that you would, you know, imply that at all. I see you getting fully into it too, like doing the mountain bike races, the e-bike race on Friday night, cooking out. I mean, the whole thing, you're in.
Yeah, I mean, that's the plan, right? Like we just want to integrate into the community and just have fun racing. That's the main thing. Like I said, we're going to get a motorhome and do it right and be professional, but also enjoy it.
Are you looking for more power from your 2023 KTM or Husqvarna? Yoshimura R&D has added RS12 exhausts for the 250 and 354 strokes to their inventory. These pipes and silencers enhance the engine's throttle response, make the most of the low-end to mid-range power, and show more than a 2% gain in max torque and horsepower on the dyno. Japanese titanium, cut and shaped in America, and distributed exclusively by Western Power Sports. Visit yoshimura-rd.com for more. So, you know, as you even mentioned, as this deal came together when you talked to Ziggy at Factory Connection, you know, everybody knows you've been wanting to race, and I'm sure that there have been some other opportunities, maybe a motocross deal that's out there, World Supercross, something else. How close have you gotten to pulling the trigger on making something happen? And what was it about this situation where you're like, this is the one. This is the one that I know I have to do because it's not going to get much better than this.
Yeah, I mean, there was some big opportunities last year whenever I felt like my back was close to good, but I was afraid to get someone in a pickle, you know, with fill-in rides or whatever. And also, you know, with the World Supercross thing, but I just – you know, Supercross is such a fine line to do it and do it right, and I don't want to do it and do it halfway. So it just in the end, it didn't quite make sense for me to go that route. And this seems like, first of all, like the G load for my back mainly is not nearly as high when it comes to off-road riding. You do a lot of standing. There's no seat bouncing, you know, nothing like that. So I don't have any concerns about my back, but definitely this is a much easier route. Yeah, the duration is a lot more, but I just the actual load isn't quite as much. Number two, this was an easy way for my family to still be able to go, for us to have a really good time. The schedule it starts at the end of January, go to the middle of June, and then I don't have another race until the middle of September. So we have all of June, August, June, July, August, and half of September off. So, you know, it's a really cool schedule. Basically do 17 rounds in the beginning of the year, and then three rounds at the end and I'm done, you know? So it's kind of like it's a huge opportunity for me to go racing. A, to sum up or answer your question. B, it's a lot less strenuous of a schedule in terms of travel and time away from home and things of that nature, than motocross and supercross. And also I just felt like, GNCC was kind of the spot for me. It's something I've always wanted to do, like I said, and I just felt led to be here.
All right. So then you said 2-year deal, XC2 this year, XC1 next year. And then it kind of does get open after that because you hit that middle 30s point of what you want to do. But I think of something that you and I talked about back when you got your Transworld cover for the Husky shoot years and years ago at your house. And you're like, I saw a KTM Dakar bike when I went to Mattagoffin. And just ever since that point, I've thought about that. So are you still open to exploring something that big? Or is seeing Shorty and Sam Sunderland and Toby Price and all these guys and what it takes to get to that point, is that, do you think that's an option or is that almost too much of a dream right now?
I don't know. I'm getting older. You know, I think I needed to start that like the day that I quit racing motocross, and that wasn't really an opportunity. I've spoken to some teams last year about it. Big, you know, sizable teams that are plenty good enough to win. But it just, man, it's just maybe one of those things that I can watch like NASCAR and be like, man, that's a cool sport, you know? Mm-hmm. I'm not sure that I'm in a position just with life and family and everything, to start over that heavy. Like, you know, GNCC is starting over a little bit, but that's starting over in the deep end, and I'm playing in the kiddie end, I guess you would say, in terms of difference of what I'm used to and all that stuff and things to learn and et cetera, et cetera. So for me, I think that dream may be dead. I'm super grateful to my wife for allowing me to take this opportunity. You know, neither one of us really felt like we got the closure or, like just kind of we're done, I guess you would say. So I'm grateful to her for, you know, we have a brand new 3-day-old baby, 2 kids that are homeschooled, and now I decide I want to take this job for 2 years, and she's been all in on board since I mentioned it, you know? So for me, it's a huge part, you know, for the next chapters for them, you know, and this part of this one is too. But I think it's a lot to ask of them to start over again at 35 and go to the middle of the desert and go wide open.
Yeah. Yeah. Even when Shorty started doing that, the fear level that I had, like every morning I would wake up and like, okay, is Andrew okay? You know, and what Jackie and Emma and Hudson went through for Andrew to be gone as much as he did just to learn road books and learn what it takes to go to these places. It's a big ask, you know?
Right. But yeah. That's a totally different deal. I can ride GNCC style trails 30 minutes from my house. You know what I mean? And to go and do Dakar, right? Which I'm not going to do it halfway, like I said earlier, but also like, you know, just knowing those things and having those days where you're out there for 12 or 15 hours, those are huge, huge days, huge ask for your family, huge ask of everyone. Plus, you know, just the risk and the travel time to get to a desert. Well, I mean, the nearest desert to me is freaking Nevada, right? Like I live in Florida. So that's just a whole nother level of different, that I don't think I am going to have left in me after this tenure in GNCC.
Okay, so then back to the GNCC thing, and great, that was a great answer. I could talk to you about Dakar forever, especially as it comes up at the end of the month. Like people really,
I know, I can't wait.
I can't wait. Pay attention to it because they are gonna be ripping this year. It's an all time.
I know.
It's all time.
I know.
So you said you can, you know, ride GNCC trails. Style trails 35 minutes from the house, and it's just the endless sand rollers and the tree roots that are under there and all that. How accessible is it in Florida? Because we know it's such a motocross hub, but then, you know, Caleb Russell was down at Alden's place for years doing laps, and it's got that same little community. So this isn't going to be a huge stretch for you, right?
Yeah, that's right. I mean, for me, obviously I have Croom, which is 30 minutes away. It's a very well-known state park that has a huge trail riding area and a big sand pit that you can just kind of make your own track. So that's super handy. I'm going to continue with training Jack Chambers and helping him. And he has a nice little facility going at the moment with an outdoor track, and we're starting to make some trails there. So that's that's pretty clutch. And then there's just some local guys that have trails around my house here that are pretty easy to get to. So it's, you know, it's the same as going riding motocross, or maybe even easier for me at the moment. I have a practice mechanic. I've put all the pieces in place to do it in the most, let's say, motocross way I know how, which is, I feel like, the most professional way I can do it and make like a proper effort at giving myself the best opportunity, and in turn, you know, the team and everybody that's in place. So it's really a pretty easy setup to get some riding in.
And you have pretty good amount of time too. You'll have these next few weeks to shake down the bike and learn a lot about the YZ250FX, and then hit January, start the boot camp. First races in Florida this year, right? Or it's nearby. It's at least like 3 hours away. So you'll have a lot of time to just kind of get into this new routine and learn the new challenges and the new methods that you got to go through.
Yeah. I've already started riding the bike, and I'm in a good spot. I've been riding for a couple weeks now, and you know, I never really stopped riding over the summer. I took a couple of like 6 week breaks to see if I could really like shake the, hey, I want to race bug. And I couldn't. And then when I started riding again, I was like, why'd you stop riding? That was dumb. For me, you know, I just lost my train of thought completely.
It happens to me all the time.
What was your question?
Like, this is going to be fun, just to learn the bike, learn the methods. Learn that kind of stuff. Like, that's your whole beat, is just how do you get better at it?
Yeah, exactly. So, sorry, I blanked out there. For me, it's just how good can I do, or how good can I be? I'm going to give it my all, put up. You know, a proper effort into it, like I said, and just put myself in good positions and try to bring, not in a bad way, but try to bring a motocross level of professionalism to the GNCC side of things.
Yeah, I could see how you, especially with the way you and Brittany just approach everything, how much you guys cook, all the stuff that you guys make and all that. This doesn't seem like the chicken and steamed rice and broccoli diet that Moto had to have. Like, you need to be doing a lot of different stuff that I think is going to make you happier, because you get to really explore that stuff rather than cutting off big chunks of your life as a sacrifice.
Yeah, exactly. That's another piece of, you know, one of the questions you asked me earlier about just kind of why this one made sense. And it's, you know, it's just a different life and a different vibe altogether, I feel like, than motocross and supercross, where, like I said, you know, everything's measured, your sleep, your poop, your intake, like everything's measured, right? So for me, this is just like a breath of fresh air on not how loose you can be, but how just different it is, I guess you would say. I mean, I'm stoked to experience it. You know, we have a pretty big test coming up. It's a week-long test in South Carolina, up at Randy's place in 2 weeks, and I think that'll be a really good start for me. And then after that, I'll start riding the 250 more. Like you said, kind of a training camp starts in January, and getting things kind of squared away for the series.
So, you know, we know you've watched all forms of motorcycle riding, and I'm sure as more people get interested in off-road as time goes on, who are some guys that you look at and you're like, man, that guy's, he's sick. Like, he's got the skill, or he can do this or that. You know, I can think of a few people that I follow, like Manny Lettenbickler, Graham Jarvis, you know, Billy Bolt, all the standard guys that make like Euro super enduro stuff stand out. And then we know the guys in the US that have made so many people fans, Linden, all of that. So who do you think that people really need to pay attention to that could, be quick moto fans?
Man, Billy Bolt, like, bike skills wise, has to be one of the best ever. Toby Price, I think he's one of the most underrated, like, all around riders ever. I think he's kind of almost unfortunately known as a Dakar rider, but he's so good at motocross riding and motorcycle riding in general. Like, I feel like he doesn't even get the credit that he deserves. I mean, the GNCC guys are gnarly for a different way, right? Like, 3 hours is no joke, and everyone knows that. I went out and did that works race at Mesquite, and like, the speed that those guys are going down some of those straightaways was scary. And they're like, oh, this isn't even a fast one. I'm like, I don't really care what it is or isn't. It's freaking scary. Like, this is ridiculous. So, I mean, everybody's gnarly in their own way, but like, for me, when Billy posts a video or Toby's doing something, I'm paying attention.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I, I agree. There's some of those guys, like especially with Manny, all the stuff that you see him get into and the events that they ride at, just and the way they appreciate where they're riding at, rather than just being so confined in it, they understand like, hey, we're out in nature and isn't this beautiful and look at where our bikes take us to.
Yeah, exactly. I think that's another thing about off-road is like you kind of have the time or the wherewithal to slow down a little bit and enjoy that. You know, I've been a ton of places in my life, but I've been to motocross tracks in those places. That's one of the things I wish I had done more or maybe could have afforded to do more was when I was in Europe, just, hey, like take a 3-hour detour, you know, it's not really that important. Like just do something else for a day and see a site or, you know, say you've been there or whatever. So, with this, like I said, we plan to get a motorhome and, drive to the races so we can stop and see some things. We've already got a couple of, points on the map that Emery's super interested in going to, the Arc experience in, I think it's in like Western Kentucky. There's a couple of beach trips we want to do and, snowshoe. We're all looking forward to that one because it's on a mountaintop and there's a cool satellite over there at Green Bank. Just some different things for the kids too. You know, we can all kind of take that in and take in nature too.
A lot of places you've probably been around your whole life too.
Yeah, for sure. I think I saw the sprint schedule earlier and I think there was 3 races in Virginia there, and one of them is literally like 3 minutes from my dad's house and the farm I grew up on. So, super cool for me.
Cool. All right. Last question. And this will be a very good Zach answer because I know how you think. You've told me enough over the years. Where will your mind wander to in 3 hours?
Man, I don't know. It's that third hour. You learn a lot about yourself and some dark places, I think. Right. But, I don't know. I love, so my wife obviously had a completely natural birth and it was one of the most amazing things I've ever seen. Like she never got loud. She never cried. She was just completely calm and like rhythmic breathing through the whole thing. And I was just like, holy crap, this is really gnarly. And then we were talking about it last night and she was like, I was just like in this zone. And I was like, yes, like you've now felt like the thing that I talk about all the time, like that Vegas Supercross feeling where there's nothing else in your brain. Like it's like the ultimate peaceful spot. I mean, obviously that's where I hope I can get to. And I think that's when your best self and like, you know, the easy things pour out of you, the things that you've trained to do pour out of you. So, for me, I really hope that I can just kind of enjoy the moment and be fully engaged in the racing and, put on a good show.
That was the most Zach answer possible. I love it. That was sick. That was sick, yeah. No, dude, because you and I have talked so many times over the years, and really, you're one of the guys that have helped me understand the attitude of being a racer. Like, you know, you can watch this stuff forever, but until you have someone that's in the moment break it down for you and tell you the things that they're going through, and every guy's different, you don't see the beauty of racing and all the little complexities that come with it. You're one of the guys that can really convey that stuff. So I appreciate this time that you had with me today. I'm excited to see you get after it. I'm going to have to come to a GNCC now and watch your ride.
Heck yeah, dude. The Florida one's right after Daytona, so that'd be really easy.
Okay, I'll try. That's one that I've always been very interested in, too, ever since I read about just the endless whoops and how the roots come through and they just rip your hands apart because everybody's hands are all soft from the start of the year.
Should be really fun, right?
Yeah, I can definitely make my hands like just raw hamburger meat for that first one. Yeah.
Oh, awesome.
All right. Thanks, bud.
Thanks, Michael. I appreciate it, bud.